Overnight lows won't be quite as cold. We've got the rain early Saturday. Sunday, we're going to watch this one. A couple computer models would like to go one way and others want to go another. But the bottom line is it's going to be cloudy and we'll just watch for moisture. And then we're going to look at cold weather returning in a big way Monday and Tuesday. That's right. Back in the teens, highs in the 30s. You've seen that before. You're going to see it again.
The graphic behind the 7-day looks so cold.
We tried to kind of give you that subliminal message there.
You brought it home, Robin.
The visuals, they tell the story.
All right, thanks, Robin. A little hoops going inside. I know. Castle Coliseum, the Tech basketball team getting back to work in the ACC.
See you at home against Wake Forest. Plus, we'll sit down with Hokies football coach Justin Fuente, who's been extremely busy in his first month on the job.
A bill could go in front of the General Assembly that could lead towards decriminalizing marijuana. Tonight at 11, I speak to people in our area on what they are saying the benefits and drawbacks are to the idea.
Sports from your hometown news leader, WDBJ 7.
Coming up Saturday's 24-point loss to Duke, the Hokies return to Castle Coliseum tonight to continue ACC play against Wake Forest at 9 o'clock. One thing they learned from that loss is to lock down on defense early so they're not playing catch-up like they were against the Blue Devils.
It's very important, actually. Like that's one of our mottos, is throw the first punch, always come out swinging. And I mean, they got the tip, and I think they hit their first their first four shots like off the bat. So it was kind of rough to start the game like that. But I knew our punch was coming, and it kind of came later than we thought. So that was hard for us. We could have kept our hands high. Like we knew there were shooters coming in the game, but our hands were kind of by our sides for most of the game, and they were able to shoot it kind of with us right there in their face.
It's been a whirlwind last month for new Tech football coach Justin Fuente between relocating, assembling a staff, and recruiting. We sat down with Coach Fuente this morning, just 3 weeks away from his first national signing day in Blacksburg. Coach Fuente, kind enough to share some time with us here this morning. First off, let me just ask you about the past month. I know it's been a whirlwind. How's the transition been for you?
It's been great. You know, the people of Blacksburg and Virginia Tech have welcomed us with open arms. We're still in the process of getting everything worked out family-wise, but I'm optimistic that I'll have everybody here in the next week.
Your staff is in place. I know you've already started to have some meetings with those guys. It's a unique staff. It's made up of guys from Memphis that were on staff there with you and some holdovers from the staff here. How has that chemistry been, and how have those guys meshed together?
I've been really happy with it, and it's like I thought it would go. Good people are good people, whether they're from Virginia or Tennessee or Texas or wherever, and our guys have hit it off right from the start. There's a definite comfort level with each other.
Let me ask you about you personally, your style as a coach. I know you're a meticulous guy and one that pays attention to the details when it comes to coaching the game.
I enjoy coaching the kids. I didn't become a head coach to just be a CEO. The day that I can't get out there and coach is the day I'll hang it up, because I really want to be hands-on. I get involved a little bit in our off-season program and then obviously in spring practice. So when we hit the football field, it's about business. It's about football, and it's a very clear direction. And then as soon as that last whistle blows, or the last second goes off the period clock for the last moment of practice, then it's back to being about life and making sure our kids are doing well in the other facets of their lives, and making sure we're doing a great job providing them the things they need to be successful.
Signing day is 3 weeks away. I know you guys have been pounding the pavement, working hard on the recruiting trail. What do the next 3 weeks look like for you and the staff?
Well, we've got a bunch of guys we've got to hit. We've got to start developing the next year's class. We brought several guys in at midterm, as many as I've ever been a part of, high school kids. So that kind of took a big chunk out of what we've got left to do. But we've got some specific targets we'll go hit, and battles we're in the middle of that we'll go fight, and also turn our eye towards the next class and making sure we're doing a great job evaluating those kids.
You mentioned in your press conference about winning the state of Virginia in recruiting. I saw a lot of the staff at some of the high school playoff games around the state back in December, the semifinal games. How have you guys been received out there by the high school coaches?
Really well. Obviously we've got some guys on staff that already have great connections in the state. It is a priority for us. There's a couple aspects of that, and that's servicing the state in terms of clinics and making sure we're getting out and making ourselves available to help the high school coaches in their careers and in their development as coaches. We make sure we do those things in the springtime. Obviously there's recruiting and evaluating and building that relationship of honesty and trust that you have to have in order to effectively recruit an area.
All right, part two of our interview coming up tomorrow. He got some good news just a few minutes ago. Tight end Bucky Hodges returning for next season in Blacksburg.
Wow. All right. Thank you, Travis. Another down day on Wall Street as the market continues to see triple-digit losses. The Dow plummeted 365 points. NASDAQ dipped 160. S&P dropped 48.
This is your hometown news leader, WDBJ 7.
Happening now, police are searching a wooded area near Danville after a body was found.
An optimistic start to a General Assembly session that also promises plenty of controversy.
Obviously, we've had a lot of irons in the fire, but we've had a lot of help as well, so it's gone pretty smoothly.
The last month has been a blur for New Tech head football coach Justin Fuente. We'll talk about his staff and recruiting, among other topics, later in sports.
And less wind, but still cold tonight. A look at the numbers just ahead.
This is WDBJ 7 at 6. I'm Melissa Gayona in tonight for Chris Hurst.
And I'm Jane Jadhan. A developing story in Pennsylvania County, where a body was found in the woods this afternoon. WDBJ 7's Danielle Staub joins us now. Danielle, what can you tell us about the investigation?
Jean, right now, the Pennsylvania County Sheriff's Office and the Danville Police are on scene. About an hour ago, this crime scene tape went up around the home. And now, to be clear, where I'm standing is in the city of Danville, within the city limits. And where the body was found on the other side of the home in the woods is Pennsylvania County. Around 2:30 this afternoon, police say they got a 911 call. What that person said or who called is unknown at this time. Officers say the body was found behind this home on Seminole Drive. Now, the Pennsylvania County Sheriff's Office is handling this investigation. I'm told they will be here for quite some time. Stay with WDBJ7 tonight and WDBJ7.com for more information. For now, I'm live in Pennsylvania County. Danielle Staub, WDBJ7.
State lawmakers return to Richmond today for the start of the General Assembly session.
And tonight, Governor Terry McAuliffe is laying out his priorities for the 60-day session. WDBJ7's Joe DeShiel is at Capitol Square tonight with a preview. Joe.
Well, Gene and Melissa, Governor Terry McAuliffe says he plans to present a comprehensive speech that will lay out the framework for the next 2 years. What he doesn't want to see, he says, are partisan petty battles that will prevent the state from making progress. McAuliffe struck an optimistic note as he sat down with lawmakers Wednesday afternoon.
This is our opportunity to shine, to take advantage of the next 2 years, to build and grow and diversify this economy.
Medicaid expansion is going nowhere fast, but as lawmakers craft a new two-year budget, McAuliffe says there are areas where they can agree.
So I think education, clearly. I believe economic development issues, giving us the tools to be competitive. As well as the veterans issues. Those are the three big issues that I said would be the cornerstone of our budget, which it is.
McAuliffe's Democratic supporters say they're hopeful. His Republican critics, wary.
The unemployment rate is the lowest it's been in 41 years. We have a modest surplus. He's appropriating or recommending an awful lot of money to higher education and public education. I think that's particularly important.
His budget is ballooned to a 13% increase, way more than it should be. He's built it on artificial numbers through Medicaid expansion and taxes on hospitals, which aren't going to happen. So we're going to have a lot of work to do this session to fix a lot of the stuff he's done.
No matter the reaction, Governor McAuliffe will enjoy tonight's speech a whole lot more than last year's. He delivered the State of the Commonwealth address last year with 7 broken ribs and a punctured lung after falling from a horse on vacation. He says he's feeling much better and looking forward to breathing easier tonight. Live in Richmond, Joe DeShiel, WDBJ 7.
And you can watch Governor McAuliffe's State of the Commonwealth address tonight at 7. We are live streaming it on our website, WDBJ7.com. New at 6, these two people are now charged with second-degree murder after a pit bull attack that killed a 15-month-old child. The sheriff's office says John Underwood II and Tara Connell were babysitting the child when the attack happened in Grayson County on January 6th. The child died 2 days later. Investigators previously said that illegal drugs and ammunition were found in the home. They also interviewed witnesses who saw the dog being aggressive toward other animals and humans.
New details tonight about a Pennsylvania County man facing sex crimes involving a minor. William Leopold was arrested Friday. According to a search warrant, he admitted to having sex with a 16-year-old. He also told an investigator he received naked pictures from the teenager. Leopold has a bond appeal hearing tomorrow.
Well, you knew it was going to be cold this morning, and it certainly didn't let us down. Temperatures were mighty, mighty frosty indeed. First alert Doppler radar at the moment actually looks pretty good. We don't have any precipitation nearby. We'll widen the view out to where it is, and that is in the snow belt area from Cleveland up toward Milwaukee and Green Bay over toward Buffalo and Syracuse. This is the favored location with this wind flow, these temperatures. They're getting some pretty decent icing and snowing up there. Just kind of watching our local scene here and finding that it's going to be a chilly one tonight. It's already dropped down into the mid-20s in Tazewell, Buena Vista 28, Big Island at 29, and Covington Middle School at 28 degrees right now, trending toward a mainly sunny Thursday. Well, that's good news there. And with winds now starting to shift out of the west, that means temperatures will have a chance to warm up as well by about 3 o'clock or so. We expect temperatures to be at about 50 degrees. Won't that be a pleasant change? More on the forecast coming up.
A Swedish company is opening its first facility in the United States right here in Henry County. And Star Springs will bring 68 new jobs and invest $3.7 million into the operation. It'll be located in this building on Fontaine Drive in Ridgeway. The company makes springs for the automotive and bedding industries. Star Springs CEO says the incentives to come to Virginia helped them make the decision to move there.
Potential customers here in the east part of the U.S. So that's one reason, and we need to be close to customers. And our market research also showed that this is a good area. We have had great support from the EDC.
The company has factories in Sweden, Poland, and Brazil, and the Henry County facility plans to be in full production in mid-2017.
The Powerball jackpot is huge, more than $1.5 billion. But before you get too excited, a reminder of the very slim odds of winning it.
$292,201,338. Those are the odds of winning.
Julie Clark teaches math at Hollins University. She knows numbers. She says you have a better chance of becoming president of the United States or getting struck by lightning. In fact, the odds are so slim, no one has won the Powerball jackpot in 19 consecutive drawings. So what about buying more than one ticket? Guess what? That doesn't really matter much either with such long odds.
Realistically, they do not go up enough with 100 tickets to make it worth spending the $200 that you're doing.
Clark says if you spend a couple of bucks to take a chance, great. But if you shell out more on lottery tickets, you'd be better off, she says, saving the extra cash or using it for something your family really needs. But what if you do wind up being that lucky winner in tonight's drawing? What's next? According to one business expert, you should call for help immediately. Dr. George Lowe, the dean of Radford University's College of Business and Economics, says contact a financial advisor before you collect your winnings. He says many times people spend too much too soon before getting advice, and then they run out of money. But with 9 different prizes available, it's not just the jackpot winner who should ask for help.
If it's more than your annual earnings, or maybe even more than your monthly earnings, that's probably time to get outside advice. Anything over 10,000, I would say, is probably worth getting a professional involved in.
Now, you would need to match 4 white balls and the red Powerball to go over $10,000 in winnings.
New at 6.
A Bath County Elementary is one of the highest scoring in the state, and this might be the reason why. Tonight, we take you inside the classroom.
When I win later tonight, we're going to see a $40 million increase into our general fund. As we've grown our economy overall, We've also sharpened our competitive edge in high-growth industries like cybersecurity and biolife sciences. Last month, Virginia beat out 46 other states for a new Air Force Cyber Operations Squadron to be located at Langley Air Force Base. And tomorrow, I will be in Northern Virginia to cut the ribbon on Visa's new state-of-the-art Cyber Fusion Center. This will lead the country in threat detection and command and control operations for the world's largest payment network. And I'm proud to say that Virginia beat out Colorado and Texas for that honor. Here in Virginia, we've also steadily accelerated our push to increase exports of all Virginia products and services to global markets everywhere. Why? Because 95% of the world's customers live outside the United States of America. And 81% of all global economic growth will occur outside the U.S. between now and 2020. We have visited those markets personally, opening up India to Virginia-grown apples for the first time in our history. And we've worked to lift the bans on poultry in Oman and Kuwait. And just this week, we received our first order ever for 2 containers of poultry that will be shipped to Oman. And last week, we traveled to Cuba, and I'm proud that we were able to forge a deal between Virginia's port and the new billion-dollar port of Mariel. We've also assisted 692 Virginia companies eager to tap international markets through our trade programs. And 182 of those businesses have traveled overseas to make personal connections with new customers and new opportunities. With us tonight is Vanessa Christie, Vice President of the Virginia-based company Prevalence, with more than 100 employees. Vanessa is a United States Navy combat veteran who spent the majority of her active duty flying and instructing the F-14 Tomcat. Her company has historically provided engineering and flight service training to the Pentagon and NATO. But now, she is moving into international markets. In the first year of participation in our valet program, Vanessa has joined our trade missions to the UK, Canada, and Mexico, and she has already 6 return business trips scheduled to these international markets this year. This is a defense contractor who is diversifying and creating jobs for Virginians. I want to thank Vanessa for being here tonight. Thank her for what she's doing to grow jobs here in Virginia. And most importantly, thank her for her service to our great country. We've also worked together to strengthen Virginia's agriculture exports. Last year, we exported a record $3.35 billion in ag products, which moved us up to the number 2 spot on the East Coast, leapfrogging North Carolina and putting Georgia squarely in our sights. To move ahead to meet my goal of making Virginia the number 1 ag exporting port on the entire East Coast. Our successes in global trade are at the center of the important work that we are doing to build the new economy, and they are a clear example of the benefits that happen when we all work together. I want to thank the support of Delegate Landis and Senator Emmett Hanger for all the great work that they have done on economic development funding for us, such as Steve, I hope I didn't hurt you in the caucus, but it is what. There's another career gone. But the great work that we've done together working on AFIT grants gives us the opportunity and the tools we need to open up new markets and businesses to make sure that we can reach producers all over the Commonwealth. I'm pleased to see that there is a bipartisan backing of the $38.9 million in our budget to partner with Go Virginia as it fosters regional collaboration among businesses, government, and education leaders to help us achieve our shared economic goals. These are not partisan successes. These are Virginia's successes. And I believe, folks, that we are just warming up. As we ship Virginia products to trade partners all over the globe, we are also making great progress in strengthening our energy economy and diversifying our fuel mix here at home. As you know, we recently announced a historic 80-megawatt solar facility that will power Amazon Web Services data centers in Northern Virginia. This will be the largest solar facility in the Mid-Atlantic and the second largest on the entire East Coast. It will more than quadruple the amount of solar currently installed in the Commonwealth. We are also doing our part to power up the solar industry in Virginia with our goal to purchase 8% of the electricity needed to run state government from solar generation within the next 3 years. Friends, that is a 100-fold increase in solar capacity here in Virginia. We will make Virginia more energy independent and stimulate economic growth by expanding our use of renewable energy. Recently, we met with the leaders of Microsoft, Google, and Amazon, and they made it perfectly clear to me that they will only do business and create jobs in states that can provide them with renewable power to generate their operations. Renewable also offers an opportunity in many of our rural communities to rebuild our manufacturing sector so that every single solar panel or wind turbine that we install has a big stamp on it, made in Virginia. I'm proud of what we've achieved working together the past 2 years to build our economy. And the budget that I presented to you in December takes even more aggressive steps to build on our momentum. According to an analysis by Trimura Economics and Analytics, our $2.43 billion bond package alone will be a major boost to our economy. $3.5 billion in economic impact through 2021 from construction expenditures. More than 19,000 new jobs, primarily in construction and related industries. And the largest capital investment in research in our history, with an emphasis on emerging sectors like bioscience. Nearly $850 million in bonds are designated for our four-year universities and $214 million for our community colleges to strengthen and expand STEM and workforce programs. In addition to significant capital investments in research and development, the two-year budget before you provides more than $1 billion in new funds all across all levels of education. We have proposed a significant infusion of resources into our public schools, including $139 million to fund 2,500 additional instructional positions. We will take Virginia's investment in public education to $6.8 billion in fiscal year 18, the largest level in the Commonwealth's history. Now, this does not mean that we should invest tax dollars in education just for the sake of it. We should invest in smart, innovative programs that get results for the students, the communities, and the businesses that we serve. We have already made a great start. Lieutenant Governor Ralph Northam and his team work closely with us to win a $17.5 million annual grant from the United States Department of Education to provide high-quality pre-kindergarten classes for 13,000 children. We began reforming our standards of learning by eliminating 5 SOL tests. We made the testing process better without watering down the high standards that we set for our schools and we set for our students. My team worked closely with leaders in this room like Senator John Miller and Delegate Tag Greeson to oversee these important reforms, and the results speak for themselves. Listen to this. 5-point gains in reading and math pass rates, improvements in writing, science, and history, a 7-point increase in math pass rates among African American students, and a 6-point gain in reading. And today, 1,414 of our public schools are now fully accredited, a 10-point increase from the prior year. So now is not the time to let up. Let us use these 60 days to strengthen our investment in education, further our reforms of our standard of learning, and make every single Virginia classroom a place where students are being prepared to lead in the 21st century. I can usually count on Lionel. We can start by using new technologies to evaluate student learning without subjecting them to 6-hour SOL tests. I know every member of the General Assembly has heard from parents about third graders having to take 6-hour tests. If we work together to provide the necessary resources, by the spring of 2017, we can reduce the time most Virginia students spend taking SOL tests to less than 2 hours through computer adaptive testing. As important as it is to reduce and to shorten tests, it is just a small piece of the work that we must do to build the education system that we need to lead in a global economy. Virginia students hold the key to innovation, entrepreneurship, and economic growth. What we put into our schools today will be what we get out of our economy 10, 20, and 50 years from today. You cannot build an economy for 2050 with a 1950s approach to education. So this year, I have proposed legislation to begin a fundamental change in Virginia's approach to high school education. We will put greater emphasis on hands-on learning, internships, early college courses, industry credentials, rather than classroom seat time. Our high schools were designed during the Industrial Revolution to prepare workers with the basic information and skills needed for the jobs of that day and time. This is a particularly urgent matter for more than 2 million Virginians living in rural regions. As Governor Jerry Beliles has noted in his work on the Rural Virginia Horseshoe Initiative, 21%, or more than 400,000 rural residents, have less than a high school diploma. Our educators are eager to create the schools of the future, and they are already starting. Here in the Richmond area, a new code RVA school is opening up next fall that will prepare students to learn code writing. Students will obtain a high school diploma in 2 years and get a community college 2-year degree while working in real computer science jobs. The students who graduate from this school, let me be very clear, will not have any trouble finding a job. And to all the parents who are watching tonight, right now, we have 17,000 cyber jobs open, and the average starting pay is $88,000. For those of you old enough to remember the movie The Graduate, the key word was plastics. Well, folks, today it's cyber. These new high schools that we are designing will benefit students like James Deloche an eighth grader in Goochland County, who is already a skilled coder and has even designed award-winning app already. So folks, our future. Let us welcome James, who is here to represent all the future code writers here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We thank James for being with us tonight. If we're going to prepare students for the jobs of today and create the jobs of tomorrow, we must fundamentally change the way we think about education. That innovative approach should even extend to the services that we offer to students who face unique challenges, like military-dependent children, transitioning to new lives here in the Commonwealth. We passed legislation last year to ensure that our schools are doing everything they can to support the concerns of children of our active duty military families as they transition in and out of our public school system. I do want to thank for the First Lady once again for her leadership on this issue. And as we take a new approach to public education, we cannot ignore the fundamental problem that far too many students, one in six, in fact, lack the basic nutrition they need to fulfill their potential. I am proud of the progress that we have made on this important issue. I want to thank the First Lady once again for her tremendous outreach and advocacy, because today, 100,000 Virginia students in 26 school divisions are now benefiting from the community eligibility provision, which allows schools to provide meals at no cost to the students or their families. Across the nation, school participation in this new federal program expanded by 20%. Here in Virginia, we knocked it out of the park. We expanded by 139%. We worked together last year to include funding in the budget to support school breakfast programs across Virginia, ensuring that all children start the day ready to learn. Those dollars today are helping 244 schools expand their breakfast programs. But we had an additional 310 schools seek funding that we were not able to support. I want to recognize a special guest who's also here with us tonight. Amanda Warren is the supervisor of school nutrition programs at Stanton City Public Schools. Out of four schools that applied that she was working with, two were approved to receive additional support for school breakfast. At Bessie Weller Elementary School, Amanda has been able to increase breakfast participation among her students from 33% to 91%. Could you imagine what she could have done if we had funding for all four schools? That is why the budget before you doubles the funding to $2 million so that we can continue our work getting every student the basic nutrition that he or she needs to succeed in the classroom. I want to thank you, Amanda, for being here tonight and taking the leadership on this issue. A strong K-12 system in which every student has access to a world-class education is essential to building the new Virginia economy. But we cannot stop there. The budget that we will work on together also contains funding to make our higher education system more accessible to all students and to better prepare those students for the economy of the future. In this budget that you have in front of you, we invest more than $48 million new dollars to financial aid for higher education over the next 2 years. More than $50 million in incentives for colleges and universities to increase the number of students receiving degrees. and almost $25 million for Virginia's community colleges to produce more industry certifications and occupational licenses. I believe, thank you. I believe that education is a prime example of the opportunity that we have this session to work together to strengthen our economy and to make our state a better place to live. We all agree that is what Virginians sent us here to do. That is why I remain optimistic. If we can sit down at the table together in goodwill, we can find a way forward on the important issue of Medicaid expansion. Let's just look at the numbers. Each day that we do not close the coverage gap, each day, we forfeit $6.6 million in federal money. Every single month, we waste $15 million in costs to state taxpayers that could be covered entirely with federal funds. Just yesterday, as you know, Louisiana became the 31st state to expand coverage along with the District of Columbia. Must have some relatives in Louisiana. They are now reaping economic, budgetary, and quality of life benefits that we continue to leave on the table. Just this past week, I met with Governor Herbert, the chairman of the National Governors Association. He is pushing to expand coverage in the conservative state of Utah. He is at least the third conservative Republican governor who has asked me with surprise, why is it that you wouldn't bring your own money back home to get health care for your citizens? I am truly convinced that we can find a bipartisan Virginia solution that totally protects our Commonwealth's finances while taking advantage of this historic opportunity to make our state a better place to live. I ask you, please review the details of our plan with an open mind, and please work with me to reach a solution that will benefit our constituents, our hospitals, and our communities. As I have always said, my door is always open, and history is on our side. We have come together over and over again on many important issues, including support for our veterans. Our Virginia Values Veterans Program has helped to connect more than 13,000 veterans with companies eager to hire them. By 2018, we will reach our goal to help 20,000 veterans find jobs and keep them and their skills here in the Commonwealth. Oh, yeah. In addition, in partnership with Senator Louise Lucas and Leader Kirk Cox, we have also secured funding for two new veteran care centers in Northern Virginia and Hampton Roads. This is not a funny issue. This is a serious issue because the VA is not doing their job for the veterans, and if the federal government's not going to do it, we're going to do it here in Virginia. Let me say something else we should be very proud of. Virginia was the first and the only state so far to be certified in the nation to functionally end veteran homelessness in our state. Anthony Harris is here with us this evening on behalf of the hundreds of volunteers and professionals who work so hard to achieve this goal. Anthony is a Portsmouth native who served with distinction in the U.S. Army and now works at the Virginia Supportive Housing. He spent months working with one particular veteran who was living in a tent in Virginia Beach. I am happy to tell you that Anthony was able to find this man a home by Thanksgiving. This is not a one-time accomplishment. Virginia is committed to making sure that veteran homelessness is rare, brief, and a non-recurring experience from this day forward. We have put in place a community-based response and service system for identifying these individuals and quickly meeting their needs. I feel good knowing that whenever a veteran faces a crisis in the future, that he or she can be assured that people like Anthony will be there to help them. These folks served our nation, and it's up to us now to serve them. Let us give a great round of applause to thank Anthony and their entire team for the great work that they have done. Together, we can expand on these accomplishments and make meaningful investments that strengthens Virginia's position as the most veteran-friendly state in the United States of America. When we came into office promising to transform government and to put our taxpayers first, our transportation team had a good idea that they were going to be busy, and they were right. We've turned around the port, generating $13.6 million in profits last year, the first time in 7 years that this vital economic asset wasn't floundering in a sea of red. On the Midtown Downtown Tunnel project, we eased the toll burden for low-income motorists and eliminated the tolls entirely for the Martin Luther King Expressway.
Thank you, Governor.
You're welcome, Louise. On 460, we canceled that project. And we negotiated a settlement that saved our taxpayers $149 million. We have also made great progress in unlocking Northern Virginia from the congestion that keeps this dynamic region from reaching its full potential. We're adding new lanes to Interstate 66, which will allow 70,000 more people to move through that corridor each and every day. And we are finally putting an end to the wheel spinning that has kept this much-needed project from moving forward. Now, I know there's been a lot of misleading information about this issue, but the facts are clear. After years and years of inaction, commuters will now have options that will ease congestion without imposing new tolls on drivers for getting to work the same way that they always have. And it's just one of the steps that we've taken to unlock the Northern Virginia region. We're making life better for commuters by extending the 395 hot lanes north all the way to the district line, extending the southbound lanes 2 miles to clear up backups in Stafford County, and continuing to support the Silver Line all the way to Dulles and other parts of Loudoun County. Together, these projects will strengthen the economy of this key region in the entire Commonwealth. We have also partner to strengthen our pension benefits for the long term. Thanks to the bipartisan cooperation, thousands of public servants can rest assured that their retirement benefits are on firm footing. I know that this is an issue that is always on the minds of Speaker Howell and Chairman Chris Jones. Indeed, the Speaker has proposed the creation of a commission to explore the future of the Virginia retirement system. And I hope that the funds that I have in my budget can be a starting point, moving us toward a stable and sustainable program. As a first step, I hope that we will work together to fully fund our pension contribution rates by the end of the coming biennium, which will be 2 years ahead of schedule. We are all equally committed to supporting our current state workers. I am proud to be their boss, and I was proud to include pay raises in my budget for our state employees, our troopers, college faculty and staff, teachers and school personnel, deputies, and other state-supported workers. These men and women work hard to make Virginia the best place to live on Earth and best place to start a business. And you know what? They deserve a raise. As you know, it took a lot of hard work to reach agreement on ethics reform last year, but we got it done. And now the ban on gifts exceeding $100 has taken effect. Our constituents can feel more confident that we are acting in their best interests. To build on this important work, we are proposing campaign finance reforms that would prohibit legislators from fundraising during the veto session and special sessions. As I did with the gift ban, I will lead by example and introduce legislation that would ban fundraising by governors during the period when they are reviewing bills for approval or veto. And finally, we are introducing legislation to prohibit the personal use of campaign funds. These are significant steps that we can take together to send a clear message to Virginians that we are using the offices that they have entrusted to us for one purpose and one purpose alone, making their lives better. Transparency and accountability are key to keeping elected officials connected with the people with whom we serve. And so is ensuring that every Virginian who is qualified to vote has the opportunity to do so as soon as possible. Some of the most meaningful moments in my 2 years as governor have been the times when I have restored the civil rights of men and women, many of whom have struggled for years to reach that goal. We have knocked down barrier after barrier, reduced the waiting time period, shortened the application form, eliminated fees, and spread the word that we welcome you and we want you to succeed. Secretary LeVar Stoney and his team have done an amazing job, and I'm proud to announce tonight that a record 16,000 Virginians have now had their rights restored. Not that we're counting, but this is more than the last three governors combined over their full 4-year terms, and we are just warming up. I would like to invite all 16,000 of them to be here this evening, but that would be like the equivalent of inviting the entire city of Williamsburg. But Bobby Blevins is here tonight to represent them all. Bobby lost his rights more than 6 decades ago when he was just a teenager. I met Bobby shortly after his 79th birthday and had the honor of personally restoring his rights. He was in tears when he told me that he had felt like half a citizen for all those years. But on that day, he became a full citizen. And guess what? On election day, Bobby Blevins went to the polls and voted for the first time in his life. I thank you, Bobby, for being here with us tonight.
What a feeling, huh?
We also need to reach out to young people and quickly get them back on the right path when they commit a crime. Our old juvenile justice model was a failure. We spend about $186,000 on each juvenile who ends up in a Virginia correctional institution. And you know what? Almost 80% are rearrested within 3 years of release. To me, that is a waste of money. That's why our Department of Juvenile Justice is taking a new approach that emphasizes treatment, education, and preparation for a productive life outside the criminal justice system. We've already reduced the population in our juvenile correctional facilities from 600 to 350. Our budget builds on our success with a plan that will invest savings in diversion and community-based services. I know that some of the young people in the system have committed serious offenses, but I also know that they are capable of great achievements. On the Friday before Christmas, a group of young men from the Beaumont Juvenile Correction Facility came to the Executive Mansion to present Dorothy and me with a beautiful quilt that they had designed and created under the direction of their teacher, Roy Mitchell. That quilt, which required almost a year of work, is now on display in the Patrick Henry Building. And Roy is here as my guest. I want to thank Roy and his entire team who are thinking out of the box and for helping so many young people to learn valuable skills and view the promise of their lives in terms of classrooms and boardrooms, not courtrooms and jailhouses. Anthony, thank you for being here, Roy. On Friday, 73 new troopers and one special agent graduated in Virginia's 123rd class at the State Police Basic Academy. We depend on these men and women to be there in a crisis, and they depend on us to provide them with the adequate resources and to establish common sense policies in support of public safety. That is why I stood with the leaders of the Virginia State Police, sheriffs, and police chiefs to announce our Executive Order 50, designed to better enforce gun laws that are already on the books. And I'm pleased that Attorney General Mark Herring and Secretary Brian Moran are chairing our joint strike force to prosecute gun crimes. It is my hope that we can work together on reasonable solutions so we can save lives.
Thank you, sir.
We should be proud of what we've accomplished and ready to meet the challenges that we all face together. When I travel around the Commonwealth to the factory floors, the classroom, the Chamber of Commerce breakfasts, I find that Virginians are practical, honest people who want their government to focus on the essential duties and to perform them well. They want quality schools, good roads, reasonable taxes, a meaningful safety net, and sound economic policies that will stand the test of time for their children and their grandchildren. You will see their influence on every page of our budget and in every bill that we will introduce this winter. Our ideas and proposals are not partisan, nor should they be controversial. I do not expect that you will accept every single one of them, but I am optimistic that our work will be defined more than cooperation than by conflict. I hope that that same approach will be reflected in the bills that you send me for consideration as the session progresses. I am ready to work with you on all of your proposals to grow our economy, expand opportunity, make our government work better, and take better care of our taxpayer dollars. But I will not hesitate to veto legislation that I believe harms those important goals. Specifically, I am prepared to veto bills that roll back the progress that we have made on marriage equality and a woman's access to health care. I also reject proposal that limit this Commonwealth's ability to keep Virginians safe from gun violence or to react to the very clear and present danger of climate change and sea level rise. Even more important, I do hope that we will treat our newest Supreme Court Justice with the respect that she deserves as a jurist who has served our Commonwealth with honor for 22 years. Thank you. allowing politics to deny this qualified and distinguished jurist a full 12-year term would send a dangerous message about the Commonwealth's respect for the independence of the judicial branch. It is my hope that our work together this session will be devoted to productive areas where there's room for compromise, not for political sideshows that distract us from the matters that demand our urgent attention. So let us resolve this evening to spend as much of this important session as we can laying a solid foundation for the new Virginia economy that our families deserve. If we are to reach that goal, each of us has an important job to do. We must stay focused on our long-term goals. We must demand more of ourselves and each other. And we must always remember why we were elected to office in the first place. On this first day of legislative session, we will face a crucial decision that will guide us for the next 60 days. I ask you to make a commitment this evening to find a way. Find a way to bulldoze through barriers and move Virginia's economy forward. Find a way to provide all Virginians with the education and the training that they need for a good job. Find a way to build the critical infrastructure to sustain our momentum. Find a way to change lives for the better. Right now, at this moment, we can make the right choice and take the next step forward. Together, let's get to work. Thank you, and God bless the greatest state and the greatest nation on earth. Thank you very much.
Joint Assembly will come to order. The Senator from Prince William, Senator McPike. As many as favor the motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
No.
Motion is agreed to. The Senator from Roanoke, Senator Sutherland. As many as favor the motion to adjourn sine die will say aye. Those opposed, no. Motion's agreed to. The Joint Assembly has adjourned sine die. I would ask the House members and guests to remain seated as the Senate exits the chamber.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Always good to see you
soon.
The House will come to order. And again, I'm going to ask the House members to remain seated as I request that our distinguished guests on the floor of the gallery now depart the chamber. House will come to order. Does the clerk have any announcements?
Mr. Speaker, simply the schedule for tomorrow morning, Thursday, January 14th, the Legislative Sportsman's Caucus meets bright and early at 7 a.m. in the sixth floor speaker's conference room over at the GAB. The Hampton Roads Caucus will meet at 8 a.m. also in the sixth floor speaker's conference room. The Committee on Health, Welfare, and Institutions, that meeting has been canceled. No HWI tomorrow. Likewise, transportation. The House Transportation Committee will not be meeting tomorrow morning. Then the Democratic Caucus will meet at 11:30 a.m. in House Room 2. The Republican Caucus will meet at 11:30 a.m. in House Room 1. Mr. Speaker, that completes the announcements that I have at this time.
The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I move from the House adjourn today to adjourn to reconvene tomorrow at 12 noon.
Gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox, moves that when the House adjourn today to adjourn to reconvene tomorrow at 12 noon, as many as favor that motion will say aye. Those opposed, no. That motion is agreed to. The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I move the House to now adjourn.
Gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox, moves the House to now adjourn. As many as favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. That motion is agreed to. The House stands adjourned until tomorrow at 12 noon.